Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
Beautiful medley I have here, Lord. Beautiful Savior together. Thank you so much for getting our minds and hearts on the right track this morning. A number of events I want to highlight in the bulletin. First, began confirmation last Wednesday. We continue now at 5 o'clock this coming Wednesday, so confirmation students less than one is due, and look forward to a good year. This coming Saturday, not only do we have men's prayer breakfast at 8, but Beaver Creek has their bazaar beginning at 11 o'clock in the morning, and it'll continue until 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and all are welcome to come, men and women, and they have lunch there, and just a lot of fun things to do. So if you haven't been east of town, coming in from Beaver Creek today, it was light, it was dark when I went, but wow, the leaves are amazing. They've changed a lot between last week and this, so hopefully by Saturday they're still hanging in there and you get to see them. Just an extra treat to go out there. So please remember that next Saturday. There are two posters up that have a lot more information in the bulletin, so pay attention to them. But women, your district rally is going to be in Bismarck this year on October 8th. That's a week from this coming Saturday. And it'll begin at 10 o'clock Central Standard Time. I don't think we changed the daylight time until, is it November or something like that? Anyway, we'll let you know. But Central Standard, I think we're still on daylight, so it should be Central Daylight Time. Anyway, Margie Lee is going to be sharing about their short-term mission work up in Alaska this past summer. Her husband, Kevin, is recovering from surgery and heard to be doing very well, and we're sure grateful for that. So look forward to a good day there, October 8th. Then men, we get to get together a little later than that. On October 28th to the 29th, that's a Friday to a Saturday. I hate to tell you, Pastor Mike Grant is going to be our speaker. So, you know, you've got to put up with a little torture every now and then. Anyway, those of you know Mike Grant know I'm teasing. You're allowed to tease him when you get there. That's something very allowed when it comes to Mike, because you can be sure he'll be teasing you. Want to let you know that the church that's in charge of supper on Friday night for the men's retreat is Tioga, and they've got Matt Renitz in charge of fixing barbecue. And if you've ever had his barbecue, it's worth going just for that. So anyway, just to whet your appetites, that's October 28th to 29th. We have the work day, Emmanuel, fall work day on October 15th. That's a Saturday, and we're going to begin as soon as the men can get away from breakfast. We've got it down for 9 o'clock in the morning. I have a number of projects that need to get done now on the church grounds, and then we're going to begin a six-week small group study, October 5th through November 9th. We'll be meeting each Wednesday and using a resource from Voices of Martyrs. I am M, and that M is Nazarenes. Yeah, that'd be great.
Okay. It's a six-week study, and there is a 15-minute video that we watch to kick it off, and it is six inspirational video sessions will introduce you to believers who were displaced by ISIS in Iraq. Learn their names, absorb their stories, and discover how your group can serve them and serve alongside them. It's using the book I Am N, and N is the Arabic for Nazarene, speaking of Jesus. And I do have a copy of it. It is just, it's a read that's not easy to read, but it's a fascinating read. It really opens your eyes as to how we have nothing to complain about here. Absolutely nothing. So we need to know how many books we need to order. So I've got a sheet that's going to go around. If you're going to be attending, if you plan to attend, we'll order you a book. We want to be sure that we have enough so that everyone can get one. So.
Thank you, Mary. We have a Savior that's worth dying for, and I trust that we'll come to appreciate that Savior more and more as we see so many that are giving their lives rather than giving up their Savior. I think that's all the announcements. Am I forgetting anything? We will read together a call to worship. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, what is unseen is eternal. Heavenly Father, we all here to dwell and keep our eyes fixed on what is seen, and are fooled by the world's riches into thinking that that's what will fulfill our lives. And on the other hand, we're fooled by the terrible things that are happening in this world. We're tempted to think that evil is going to win in the long run. Thank you for your word today. Thank you for your word that takes our eyes from the things that we see in time and fixes them on the eternal picture. I pray that you would help us have our eyes today fixed on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising its shame. But assures us that we have victory, his victory, as he sits at your right hand. Lord, thank you that that's our victory. So Lord, I pray you call us from making a god the things of this world. Instead, today we might see your kindness, your grace, your love, and that our hearts would embrace eternal treasure in Christ. Thank you, in Jesus' name. Amen. If you're able, please, let's stand together as we open with our first hymn of praise, hymn, Give to Our God and Glory and Praise. Sinned against you in our words, actions, and our thoughts. We come to ask your forgiveness and to seek your great mercy. We come to you in the merits of Jesus Christ on our own. Look not on our sins or our iniquity. Wash us in the blood of Jesus Christ so that we may be clean before you. This we pray in Jesus' name. Continue, we pray, to be with Barry, with Vernon. Lord, we pray for Art that the door might be open for him to receive the surgery or whatever medical help he needs, or Lord, just a touch from your hand to relieve his pain. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for touching Jesse's life and Linda. Continue to be with them and help them be healed and strengthened. Lord, be with Naomi and Caleb and his parents. Be with Jeanette, Heavenly Father. And Lord, now with Kari as she waits to hear about her treatments, as she goes through them, Lord, watch over and keep her. Thank you, Heavenly Father, that the things we consider hard in this life, we can know are not punishments, we can know are not from a God who delights in torturing people. But we can know that they come from a loving Father. Lord, help us to have our eyes open that we can see how desperately we need to be weaned away from the things that capture our hearts so readily. And find that when our heart belongs to you, when we become your children, we have all that we need. Help us then to take hold of whatever you give us in this life with thankfulness, and to let go of whatever you take away from us in this life, acknowledging your wisdom and your grace. Lord, we pray that the good news of Jesus Christ might be spread throughout the world through our missionaries. We pray especially for those now who are longing to proclaim your word in places where it needs to be heard, and yet struggling with issues with visas. So Lord, we pray for Manny to grow up. Thank you that you have opened the door and you've gone up for them to be there. And we pray, Lord, that you would not close that. Pray that you would overrule the unjust rulers that are there who long to keep Christianity out. And Lord, that you would allow them to continue to teach hungry people the truth of your love. We pray the same for Brent and Emily now, Heavenly Father, that as in India they have run into difficulties with their visas, that by your grace and because of your will in desiring to reach to those who are lost in a lie called Hinduism, might get to hear the good news. So Lord, we pray you provide that they can remain to not only speak to those who live there, but also to the pastors and teach them to clearly teach and proclaim your word. Lord, watch over our nation. We pray especially today for its churches. So many, out of a desire to become large, have completely given up on clearly preaching your word and have instead said what tickling ears want to hear. I pray, Heavenly Father, that you be at work here and in the churches throughout our land, that many people would realize the shallowness of what's going on and the desire to be rid of it, and instead seek out congregations that seek to proclaim your word in its entirety, taking nothing from it and adding nothing to it. Lord, I pray that through that word today be at work in us, bringing us to repentance and faith. That through that word you would make clear to us a need, the need we have. A need that's so great that we're blind to even see it. Lord, open our eyes that we might see our need. But especially, Lord, then too, I pray you would not leave us in despair, but through that word call us to come to the provision you've made by grace for us through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Do your work in our lives through your word, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Our Old Testament lesson today comes from the prophet Amos. And it's a short passage, chapter 8, verses 4 through 7. And if you would please, in respect for God's word, let's stand as we read this portion. Hear this. You trample the needy and do away with the poor of the land, saying, when will the new moon be over that we may sell grain, and the Sabbath ended that we may market wheat, skimping the measure, boosting the price, and cheating with dishonest scales, buying the poor with silver and the needy for a pair of sandals, selling even the sweetmeats with the wheat. The Lord has sworn by the pride of Jacob that will never forget anything they have done. And we read a portion also from Paul's letter to Timothy, the first letter that he wrote. Beginning in chapter 2, some familiar verses, and then some that are sure controversial today, but God's word is God's word, so let's hear what God has to say. 1 Timothy 2, beginning at verse 1. I urge then, first of all, that requests, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for everyone, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. This is good and pleases God, our Savior, who wants all men to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Jesus, or Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all men, the testimony given in its proper time. And for this purpose I was appointed a herald and an apostle, and telling the truth and not lying, and a teacher of the true faith to the Gentiles. I want men everywhere to lift up holy hands in prayer, without anger or disputing. I also want women to dress modestly with decency and propriety, not with braided hair or gold or pearls or expensive clothes, but with good deeds, appropriate for women who profess to worship God. A woman should learn in quietness and full submission. I do not permit a woman to teach or to have authority over a man. She must be silent. For Adam was formed first, then Eve, and Adam was not the one deceived. It was the woman who was deceived and became a sinner. But women will be saved through childbearing if they continue in faith, love, and holiness with propriety. Here ends the reading of our scripture.
Thank you.
message, we're going to sing a song that is somewhat a prayer and somewhat just an acknowledgement of things that are true and yet things that are extremely ironic. You might want to look this hymn up when you get home and read it more. It is one of the most amazing hymns I've ever read. I think the first time I sang it, the first time I remember singing it was in prison. Please keep that in mind, as especially you read the first verse. 470, make me a captive, Lord. Fixed on that. Luke 16, 1 through 15. And again, if you're able, please stand in respect for God's word. Jesus told his disciples, and again, in the hearing of Pharisees and other crowds around them, but he's speaking specifically to his disciples, there was a rich man whose manager was accused of wasting his possessions. So he called him in and asked him, "What is this I hear about you? Give me an account of your management, because you cannot be manager any longer." The manager said to himself, What shall I do now? My master is taking away my job. I'm not strong enough to dig, and I'm ashamed to beg. I know what I'll do so that when I lose my job here, people will welcome me into their homes. So he called in each one of his master's debtors. He asked the first, how much do you owe, my master? 800 gallons of olive oil, he replied. The manager told him, take your bill, sit down quickly, and make it 400. Then he asked the second, how much do you owe? 1,000 bushels of wheat, he replied. He told him, take your bill and make it 800. The master commended. I thought it should say condemned, but it doesn't. The master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly. For the people of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own kind than are the people of the light. I tell you, he's talking to his disciples, use worldly wealth to gain friends for yourselves so that when it is gone, you will be welcomed into eternal dwellings. Whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much. Whoever is dishonest with very little is also dishonest with much. So if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? And if you have not been trustworthy with someone else's property, who will give you property of your own? No servant can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. The Pharisees, who loved money, heard all this and were sneering at Jesus. He said to them, you are the ones who justify yourselves in the eyes of men, but God knows your hearts. What is highly valued among men is detestable in God's sight. Heavenly Father, I pray that you would help us through this text, that we could see what you're telling us clearly, that we would recognize our altogether too often effort to be a servant of both God and earthly wealth. Lord, help us see who you are, that we might know that earthly wealth does come to an end, and that we might use it the way you desire to use it. Work in us, Heavenly Father, that it would be you we serve and not ourselves. We pray that you grant this for us in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. It almost seems like Jesus is encouraging dishonesty in this text. He's doing anything but. And if you remember our lesson this morning from Amos, you see that Amos was talking to people who were so eager for wealth that they could hardly wait for the Sabbath to be over. Kind of like people who love football today can hardly wait for church to be over so you can watch the Vikings lose to the Packers. I'm a Vikings fan. Anyway, this is the thing. Their hearts in Amos' day were no different than ours. People have their hearts fixed on the wrong things. By nature we do. That's the way our hearts are bent. That's the way we are by nature. We rebel against God. They could hardly wait for the Sabbath or the new moon festival to be over so that they could get out and sell their stuff. And even when they sold it, they used dishonest scales. And instead of letting their combines take out all the chaff, they'd sweep a little bit of it in there so they'd weigh more. They could get more money. They loved money in Amos' day. Thankfully, that's no longer true here in Williston, is it? We got to see what happened when an oil boom hit this town. I think many of us were ashamed and many of us were saddened. To see, I know some people say, well, market determines prices. Yeah, it does. But a lot of times people set prices with only the thought of how much they could make or how quickly they could get out of debt without regard to who they were hurting, especially those on fixed income. We saw it happen all over Williston, didn't we? heart of man hasn't changed at all. And Jesus tells us something that we need to know in this text. It's, I think, the most important thing to get out of this text. He talks about in the sight of God. Last verse, what is highly valued among men is detestable in God's sight. Does that mean God hates money? The answer to that is no. Does that mean money is evil? The answer to that is no. Does that mean earthly wealth is evil, or that things that are only temporal are awful? The answer to that is no. What's detestable in God's sight is how they're used or how they're viewed by lost and fallen humanity. And Jesus wants us to be very aware of that. This parable, as soon as I read it on Monday morning, I got a headache because it seems to commend dishonesty. It doesn't do that in the least. I think it's very important that we look carefully at what this parable has to say, not at the details so that we can make every detail have some special meaning, but at the details so that we see clearly what Jesus is teaching, the one thing he's teaching in this parable. It's a very pointed parable. So we have a rich man, and by the context, I would guess he's a rich farmer. Now I see some of you farmers there thinking that's an oxymoron. There's no such thing as a rich farmer. Well, if there aren't rich farmers today, there used to be, okay? This guy's a rich guy. Why do I come to the conclusion he's a farmer? It's because every product he's dealing with here is farm goods. And I know we don't make olive oil here, but you have to grow olives to make olive oil. So he had fields, he had orchards, he had lots of land. We're told about two of the people who he rented land out to. And those of you who farm, especially retired farmers, know how that can work and understand the kind of contracts that took place. That's what this situation is. This farmer contracted his wheat land, and he contracted out his orchard, his olive orchard, and he contracted out probably a lot of other places on his farm. And at the beginning of the season, he'd say, okay, you can farm this portion. At the end, you can keep all of it, except you're going to owe me 1,000 bushels of wheat, 800 barrels of olive oil, whatever it might be. But they agreed at the beginning of the season, that's how it was to go. I don't know if they do it with an amount nowadays, or more often perhaps it's a percentage, but that was the agreement that took place. The agreement wasn't done directly always by the master. He had a manager who took care of those business things for him. And this manager loved money. Matter of fact, he loved money so much that, like those Amos is talking to and like people that we've seen in our own day and age here in Williston, loved it so much that he wasn't honest. He did what he could to gain more money for himself without regard to what it would do to other people. And people saw it. They saw what was going on. And so they report to this manager's boss, to this rich man, this rich farmer. They tell him what's going on. This rich man maybe already suspected what was going on, but with the testimony that was given him, it was time to call in his manager. He does. Calls him in, and interesting, the conversation that takes place, it's very Middle Eastern. He says, first, what's this I hear about you? There was a long pause at that point in time. It isn't written in the text, but the reason he asked that question is he figured when this guy answers, he's going to learn more than he would otherwise. He's going to give the guy a chance to get excuses. I don't know what you've heard about me, but you have to understand this, that, and the other. You know how good we are at making excuses. What we see is something about this manager that we need to pay attention to, and that is that he says nothing. And so finally, the rich man says, it's translated here, give an account of your management because you cannot manage any longer. He has no excuse for the accusations that his boss has heard. He doesn't try to offer excuses. couple of interesting things. First of all, the manager heard these things from those who saw it going on because he was respected. He was thought to be an honest man. I mean, who cares if a dishonest, rotten scoundrel is ripped off? Nobody says anything then. So we see this man had a reputation, this rich man, of being honest, of being kind, of being a man of respect in the community, so people do report what's going on to him. Second of all, with what this manager had been doing, he had every right to have him charged, tried, and thrown in jail. He had the goods on him. But he doesn't do that to us. We need to notice those things if we're to understand what Jesus is teaching in this parable. Also, then, when he says, when it's translated, give an account of your management because you cannot be manager any longer, what he's literally saying is, you can't be manager any longer, you need to turn in the books. You need to hand them to me. And so what takes place in this parable is this guy's walking back to his office to get the books. And there's a time period now where he knows he's fired, nobody else knows he's fired. And during that time, he's thinking things over. He's a smart guy. And as he's thinking them over, he figures out what he's going to do, and it's revealed to us what he does. We know that he doesn't have a physical ability. He was a fat slob like me and couldn't dig ditches. And he was too proud to beg. So instead, and the translation here, we need to be careful, said, so he called each one of his master's debtors. That each one needs to be understood. He called them in one by one. He didn't have a group meeting with people. He took the master's debtors one by one. And he dealt with them one by one. Important to notice that Jesus does give some details here as to what he does with them one by one. Calls them in and he asks the first, how much do you owe my master? And he asks them specifically so that they say what they had contracted for. Of course, when you sign a contract, you know how much it was for. And he says, 800 gallons of olive oil. And the manager says, take your bill, sit down quickly. I don't have a lot of time for this because I need to get the books back to my boss real soon. Sit down quickly and make it 400. He cuts the bill in half. And we need to keep in mind that this one who sits down and in his own handwriting writes half the amount down is not aware that he's dealing with a manager that's been fired. He doesn't realize even this is coming from the manager as far as he's concerned. It comes from the manager's boss who is known to be a compassionate, kind man. And he thinks, well, it's been a tough year. Rain hasn't come like we thought. And so with recognizing how tough it's been, the manager's boss, this rich man, realizes I needed a break. And he gets a year and a half wage cut in what he has to pay. Same thing with the guy who has the wheat. We notice the percentage is different. Another guy is called in, the second one's called in, how much do you owe? 1,000 bushels of wheat, he replies. Told him, take your bill, make it 800. That was the same amount, actually. It's not the same percent, but it's the same cut in what this person owed his master. What's going on here? Notice there's some important details to notice. Number one, the manager doesn't sit there at his desk and as he's told what they are, saying, okay, I'm reducing it to 400 barrels. He says, you write it in there. He says the same thing, take your bill and make it 800 to the guy who owes wheat. And he does this, we don't know how many, that doesn't matter. We see what he's doing. He's allowing those who agreed at the beginning of the season to pay a certain amount for the use of the land, he allows them to reduce the amount they're going to owe at the time of harvest. And so he's doing something sneaky and dangerous. What he'd already done, he could have been thrown in jail for. And what he's doing right now is illegal. Once he's fired, he can't legally do anything on the master's behalf. And yet he does anyway. And he hides the fact that he's been fired from those who he calls in one by one. They don't know that he's fired yet. So they take it that he, on behalf of his manager, or of his boss, of this rich man, is reducing their bill. And no doubt that when their bills were reduced, they all went home and they said to each other, hey, guess what the guy we contracted with did for me? What did he do? Well, he reduced my bill by half. Wow. He reduced mine too. He reduced it by a year and a half wages. And no doubt they were throwing a party by the time word got around to this rich farmer. And the rich farmer was the center of the party. Everybody was saying, what a great guy he is. Look how generous, how loving, how kind he is. So do you see what's happening? Jesus does not commend this manager for his dishonesty. He says that the master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly. The Greek word phronimos is a word that means pertaining to understanding, resulting from insight and wisdom. It means wise or wisely or with understanding. He acted wise or wisely or with understanding. What's commended is his wisdom. What's commended is the fact that he acted according to understanding, resulting from insight. What's he saying? What he's saying is that this man's heart was held captive by wealth, and he realized that it was going to fail him. He'd been relying on wealth to make his life happy up to this point, and then when he got caught doing what was wrong, he realized his opportunity to earn wealth was going to be taken away. So what did he rely on then? Jesus doesn't say he's commended for his dishonesty. Certainly, he was dishonest. What Jesus commends him for is his acting according to understanding. How do you act according to understanding? And the answer to that is, knowing that he was taking a great risk, he threw himself completely on the mercy of his master. If his master was not merciful, he'd be in jail. But his master had a reputation of being merciful, of being kind, of being generous, of being gracious. And he was going to rest on the graciousness of his master. When he gets called in, I bet he was wondering, did I make a mistake? Is he going to tell me you're under arrest? Or is he going to commend me? And he commends him. He's right in understanding his master. That's what he's commended for, being right in understanding his master. What's Jesus saying? The master obviously is God, isn't he? And we are managers. And we're like this manager. We're dishonest. We're sinful. Sinful to the point not just of misusing things, but making things, making stuff, making money my God. Making anything God but the true God. Not recognizing my boss and the fact that I should be serving him instead of serving myself with what he's entrusted to me. We're like this manager. And if we are like this manager, what do we deserve? We deserve what this manager deserved. We deserve to be arrested, tried, and thrown in jail. What kind of jail? An eternal prison. That's what we deserve. This manager acted according to wisdom. He was shrewd. He's commended for his shrewdness because what does he understand? He understands there's only hope. It's the kindness, the generosity, the love, the grace of his boss. Is the same true for for us? The answer clearly is yes. If ever our hope rests in our cleverness or anything else, anything that we do or have, we're in trouble. We, like this manager, need to come to a point in our lives, a crisis time in our lives, perhaps again and again, and again and again and again and again. And I'll even drop, perhaps, of recognizing that our only hope rests in the grace and kindness of our Master. And indeed, He has been gracious and kind. What we deserve, we don't get. Jesus took it in our place. His grace is absolutely amazing. When that happens to us, when we come to realize how desperately we need the grace of our King, our Lord, when we come to realize it's our only hope, we're finally open to hear what He longs for us to use our money for. Jesus says the Master commended the dishonest servant because he acted shrewdly, for the people of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own kind than the people of light. What does He want us to know? I tell you, use worldly wealth to gain friends for yourselves, so that when it is gone, and it will be one day, you will be welcomed into eternal dwellings. Like this manager, He made friends. And like this manager, Jesus says the purpose that God entrusts us with earthly wealth, it isn't ours, it's His. Even as this manager did not manage his own wealth, he managed the wealth of his boss. God entrusts us with earthly wealth, and what does it do for us? It tests us. We are inclined to let that earthly wealth become our God. We're inclined toward covetousness. We're inclined toward greed. We're inclined to love that stuff so much that we make it our God, and it doesn't matter whether we're only talking about money now. It can be intelligence, it can be good looks, it can be a good reputation, whatever it might be, whatever we seek in this world to be our treasure and to be that thing that earns the attention and value from other men, and we see Jesus speaking to that, whatever it is. If we're using it in that way, we're misusing it, because it's not ours, it's God's. And that's not God's intention in entrusting it to us. His intention is that we use it in order that His love might be on display. Even as those who received a reduction in the fee they owed saw not this manager's love and kindness on display from their perspective, it was the rich man's kindness and love on display. And they were one to give Him praise. So also God longs for us to use worldly wealth that others might join us in praising God, our gracious, kind, loving God, who has not treated us as our sins deserve, but instead given us a gift that's beyond comprehension in the death and the blood of His own Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We're stewards. But we're tested stewards. In verses 10 through 12, Jesus says, who can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much, and whoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much. What's He saying? He's saying, if you can't be trusted in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? In other words, I'm entrusting you with worldly wealth right now, and if you're using it just for you, how am I going to trust you with eternal treasures, with true treasures, with riches that can't be taken away? If you've not been trustworthy with someone else's property, you see it's never been ours, it's God's. Who will give you anything that's your own? And this reminds me of the hymn we just sang, that we only have when we give up what we have. We're tested stewards. God puts us in this world and gives us a gift of wealth in this country. He's given us incredible wealth. On my way here this morning, I heard that if you're making, I think it was $35,000 a year, you're considered among the world's elites today. We don't see things in perspective because we live in a place where there's so much wealth. We've been given a great deal of it. The question is, am I letting it be my God? Is it more important to me? Is it so important that I'm neglecting those around me, that God wants me to love with that wealth, that he wants me to use to show his love to others? And it doesn't matter whether that wealth is just money. Whatever that wealth might be, whatever is of value to me, what am I using it for? This is a time when, as stewards, we're being tested. I don't really like often what I see in my own heart. And I trust the same is true for you. And that you despair of trying to fix you. You can't. But I trust that as God reveals to us this rich man, this master, that you, like this manager, fall on the grace and the kindness of the master, will change your life. And that's what Jesus wants for us. That our hearts no longer be set on things that are not God. But that we have new hearts that trust in God. Wealth is deceptive. We see the Pharisees hearing what Jesus is teaching, and it doesn't say they say anything. They're sneering at Jesus. What does he know about wealth? These are the guys who love to make a lot of riches to get a great reputation for themselves, but they gave. They gave 10%. They gave more than that sometimes, but you know why they did it? They didn't do it because they loved giving away money. They did it because they loved gaining this great reputation. Everything was about them. That's the way you are. That's the way I am by nature. Justify ourselves in the eyes of men. What kind of impression do I make? Do I have a really nice suit on? Do I have nice shiny shoes and a shiny car outside? Did everybody see that big check I put in the offering plate today? How are you using your earthly wealth? What's happening on the outside may be hidden from you. God knows what's going on in your heart. That's a scary thing, as far as I'm concerned, that God knows what's going on in my heart. It's incredibly frightening without knowing Jesus, the Savior, without knowing the heart of God, without knowing that while he sees what's going on, he responds like his boss, with mercy, with grace. Life is a time when we're constantly being tested, constantly finding no hope in ourselves, constantly having to turn to grace. In the sight of God, what? In the sight of God, if we stand alone just as who we are, we're lost. Because God knows your heart. But if you realize that God knows your heart, know his heart today too. That he longs for all men to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. Of the truth. What truth? The understanding of who God is. The understanding that he is gracious. The understanding that he, for sinners, sent a son to die. The Pharisees used to say, God hates sinners. He loves those who are righteous. And Jesus turns right around and says, no. God loves sinners. And he calls them to repent. To turn to him, to know who he is, and find hope only in him. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for showing us through this text your heart. I pray, Lord, that you would capture our hearts as we become more and more familiar with who we are. I pray that the story of your love would become more precious to us every time we hear it, because we come to know ourselves more clearly. Give us this blessing now, we pray, out of your bountiful heart. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Hear us, Lord, as we pray the prayer Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We'll close by singing 304, I love to tell the story of Jesus, his love. We'll stand as we close with this hymn. Christ Jesus, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen.